I'll turn back with the scripture that was written in Romans chapter 8, and verse 31. And before I forget, I do want to make mention of two things very quickly. If you know anybody in the Ronald Valley that's looking for a job, there will be a job fair this coming Friday morning at the Salvation Army on Day Avenue in Roanoke. My wife and I are part of several organizations that are coming together to put on that job fair in Roanoke on Friday morning at the Salvation Army on Day Avenue. But also on Friday night at 6 o'clock, there will be a meeting of clergy and law enforcement to talk about sanctuary safety and other issues at Hill Street Baptist Church. This coming Friday at 6 p.m. We'll be sharing together as brethren, as sisters of faith, asking ourselves how we could be better stewards over our sanctuaries in the area of safety. Romans chapter 8, verse 31, Paul asks this question. What shall we say to these things? Mm-hmm. If God be for us, who can be against us? Amen. If God be for us, who can be against us? I struggled with a sermon topic, and let me preface that by saying my sermon won't be long, so because I understand there's chicken downstairs. So, no.
Okay.
It is Thanksgiving. What is Thanksgiving without turkey?
So
we got dressing. I just want to make sure I had it right. And I had to get my taste buds tuned up in the right direction.
Yeah.
What shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? I asked this question this morning, not just of you, but of even of myself. What are you holding on to? I want to encourage you to hold on to what you can't see.
All right.
So ask your neighbor this question. Neighbor, what are you holding on to? Man, y'all know what? I do not like spiders, sir. Just want to throw that out there. I'm about to hang on to the spiders.
Spiders.
Don't worry, it'll come back later. Just never had really like spiders. I don't know. But anyway, you know, what are you holding on to? You know, we seem to be in a very, very precarious time in the life of our country. A time where it seems like the world keeps getting crazier and crazier, mm-hmm. and the church keeps getting quieter and quieter.
All right.
Yeah.
A world where,
oh yeah,
in my lifetime, mm-hmm. we moved from a place where drug dealers didn't deal drugs on the block the church was on.
Right.
They boomed their music all the way through town, but would turn the radio off as they passed the church.
Yeah.
To a time where people have felt comfortable walking up to the church, mm-hmm. and taking the very lives of those who are serving the God I serve.
Yeah.
I have to be honest and say that it makes me uneasy to think that this time last week, people were doing the exact thing we're doing, and they were losing their lives.
That's right.
Maybe that's just me. Maybe it's just my problem or my issue. And I look at the things I see in the news, and sometimes I have to be honest and say I have to turn the news slap off.
Yeah.
I just have to stop dealing with it from every now and then. I want to be informed. I want to make sure that because of who I am and who God has called me to be, I am, you know, informed, and I understand the issues, and I know what's going on in our communities, but every now and then I have to unplug. Because if I stay plugged in too long, the death and the destruction and the dreariness and the bad news after the bad news can almost just seem like it weighs you down.
Uh-huh.
Amen.
I look at what I see happening in our communities. In Roanoke, three shootings in the span of 10 days.
Uh-huh.
And I have to ask myself, what's going on? What is happening? And I realize that a big part of the problem is where people's heart is, where their faith is. Because I believe that people are giving up hope.
Yeah.
I believe that a big part of the problem that we see is that people are losing faith. They've walked away from their faith in God. And when you don't have faith in God, my question then becomes, what are you holding on to?
Amen.
When times get tough.
Yeah.
What are you holding on to when things get rough?
Uh-huh.
And we seem to be in a place where people find it easy to ridicule people of faith.
Yeah.
But the reality of it is, the scriptures told us, there'll be times like this.
Mm-hmm.
They said that there'll be times like this when men will become lovers of themselves. When they care more about their own personal well-being, their own lining their own pockets, and doing their own thing, that they wouldn't be caring about their fellow man.
Yeah.
They said there'd be times like this.
Mm-hmm.
They said there'd be times like this where people would stop valuing human life. And because they don't value the sanctity of human life, and they don't see other people as precious as they are, they do some foolish things.
Mm-hmm.
So, how do y'all make it? What caused you to come in here this morning? Because it was an intent. Let me stop and ask the question. Did anybody show up by accident? Did you think this was bingo or a raffle or something? You know, because you may have shown up by accident, you know. But I got up intentionally, you know, took a shower, combed my hair, put on clothes and all those things. Yeah, a little bit. Got in my car, drove with my family intentionally.
Yeah.
It wasn't by accident. It was intentionally that I arrived at this place.
Yeah.
And because I did it intentionally, I have to ask myself, why? Why come, Ken? Why do you do this intentionally? Why take the risk? Why take the step? Because it would be easy just to stay in bed, pull the covers over my head, and then because it was warm this morning. I don't know about you, but I felt good in my bed.
Yes.
Amen. Amen.
Why keep coming?
Mm-hmm.
Why keep singing the songs? Why keep holding hands and shaking and hugging necks? Why? When it seems like there's no help. When it seems like there's no hope. When it seems like all hope is gone.
Uh-huh.
That's what brings me to this text this morning. Paul, sitting in a jail, writes to the church in Rome and begins to remind them of some stuff. Because he was looking at a people and realizing that they had gotten just a little off. And you know how it is. You get up and you get a little something and you get comfortable. Because this is what had happened. The church in Rome was filled with all types of people.
Yeah.
But some of the problem was we were letting people come in, but we were making them praise and worship the way that we wanted them to. So Jews were telling Gentiles, you can't come in our church unless you do it this way.
Mm-hmm.
And they were making them do stuff that Paul was saying had nothing to do with soul salvation.
That's right.
He said, you know, yes, y'all got a lot of money. You got all the right political connections because in the time when they were killing Christians, we asked ourselves the question, how did this huge megachurch develop in Rome? It developed because some Pharisees and Sadducees had joined the church. It developed because some politicians had joined the church. And now because we had all the right people in all the right places, and we let things happen in a particular way. And then the challenge became, some of the people, because of their political status, and some of the people, because of the size of their pocketbooks, will now start to run the church.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm sure we don't ever have any of that going on nowadays. And so Paul writes a letter to remind them of where they need to be.
Yes.
He reminds them first and foremost, it's not about how much money you have.
Mm-hmm.
It's not about what job you have.
Wow.
It's not about the work you do. But it is your faith in Christ that justifies you and causes you to be right for the kingdom of God.
Yeah.
He says, I just want to remind you, having all those degrees, that's nice. Having that resume, that's nice, but it's not going to get you into heaven.
Amen.
It's not going to get you where you need to be.
That's right.
He says, I want you to know something. I'm your bishop, but I'm messed up. Read it in Romans chapter 7. He said, the good that I would do, sometimes I just don't do it. Uh-huh. I mess up sometimes. I know y'all holy people. I know y'all think y'all good Christians. You got your nice robes and nice suits, and you come in and you do all these ceremonies and services, and you make everybody else feel like they're less than what you are. But I'm your pastor, and I'm messed up. And if I'm messed up, you ought to realize you're messed up. And then he starts chapter 8 with a shout because I told you in chapter 7, I'm messed up. And God keeps blessing me even in my mess up. Because in chapter 8, he says, there is therefore now no condemnation. That's why we keep coming. Because even with our mess ups and our hang ups, there's no condemnation.
Thank you, Lord.
Then he reminds them at the beginning of the chapter that you think you're here because God owes you a favor, but the reality of it is you're here because you owe God a favor.
Amen.
Because God called you before you knew yourself.
Yeah.
And then he predestined you to be in this position working for the kingdom.
Thank you, Lord.
We want to remind people that God has a work for all of us to do.
Amen.
I heard Reverend Al Sharpton say something this week that arrested my attention. He said, some of y'all make black preachers' job hard. You make them have to work too hard. Because the hardest thing a black preacher has to do is to preach the funeral of a Negro that ain't done nothing.
All
right. I'll let that sink in. He said, we got to get up in front of your family and lie about your life. And act like you did something that amounted to something so somebody will feel good about putting you in the ground. He said, so instead of him making us lie, why don't you get up and do something that's going to be beneficial to the kingdom of God? That way, when they got you stretched out, we can praise God because your work and your living will not have been in vain.
Amen.
And I thought about that, and I said, you know, Paul was trying to remind the church that it wasn't about what you looked like, it wasn't about where you came from, what it was about was how you lived. And did you live as God had called you to live?
All right.
And see, here becomes the problem, Reverend Akers. Living as God calls you to live will put you in difficult situations.
Yeah.
Living as God calls you to live will cause you to be comfortably uncomfortable.
Amen.
I know God called me into the ministry, but I didn't know it was going to be quite like this. I know God called me to feed people, but I didn't know it was going to be feeding people like this. God calls us to do his work. Reverend Ron Dez from National Church says we ought to become the hands and the feet of Christ if we ought to be good disciples.
Yeah.
And so we are called not to just sit up in here, but to leave this place.
All right.
And to go somewhere and do something that means something in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen.
That's right.
But it's dangerous out there.
Yeah.
And we have to be honest and say that in the moments when we are called to do the work of God, that every now and then our hearts are filled with trepidation.
Because
we don't know how this is going to turn out. However, what Paul says to us earlier in the chapter is, all things work together for the good of those that love the Lord and are called according to his purpose.
Yes.
Now, let me clarify that. That does not mean if anybody and everybody that everything you do is going to work out in the way God wants it to work out. Because if you live in a life of hell, if you live doing what makes you feel good and not what pleases God, that scripture does not apply to you.
Amen.
But if you are out attending the field, if you're out, you're gathering the harvest, if you are out reaching people, if you're out feeding people, if you're out helping people, then when you run into tough times, what should spur you on is not that he promised that it would be tough times, but what he promises is those tough times are still going to work for your glory in heaven.
Yeah, all right.
There's some tough times around us.
Mm-hmm.
It is tough. So what are you holding on to? In verse 31, And I'm getting very close. Now I love black people going close 5 times, but I'm winding this thing down because this one verse of scripture shall mess with you all week long.
All right.
What shall we say to these things? Mm-hmm. What shall we say to a president who says he's a Christian but doesn't do anything that's Christ-like? What shall we say to a Congress who's elected to work on our behalf but are busy lining their own pockets?
Amen.
What shall we say to people who say they love us but use us and leave us on the side of the road?
Amen.
What shall we say to churches who want us to pay our tithes but don't speak up when people are beating us across our face? Right. What shall we say?
Amen.
To these things?
All right.
Read.
What shall we say? See, here's the issue. What we say has a lot to do with what we think.
Mm-hmm.
And then what we think is based in what we believe. So if you listen to what a person says, you can tell a lot about what they believe. And then you have to be careful about what people say, because the Bible says life and death is in the power of the tongue.
Uh-huh.
And so if you hear somebody saying something that does not sound right, then you know, conversely, that death is in their heart.
That's right.
All right. I know some people may not like that. That's all right. Yeah. But ask the question, what shall we say to these things? If somebody walks up to you and say, why are you going to church? Why are you doing this? Why are you still serving God when children are dying, when people are going hungry, when people don't have to heat their houses? Why? What shall we say to these things? What shall we say? But then he answers the question for us. And then this right there, the question, I hope you still got the Bible open.
Amen.
Right there, he says, if God be for us, who can be against us?
Right.
His faith is in God.
Amen.
Now, let me paint the picture for you. He's writing this in jail. Yeah. He's writing this, and he knows they want to lay him down and lop his head off. He knows they want to separate his ears from his shoulders.
Yeah.
But if God be for us, who can be against us?
All right.
Well, where do you get that from? I have a question. You think it's bad now? Had it been bad before, though?
Yeah.
Didn't God get you through it before?
Yeah.
Didn't God carry you over before?
Yeah.
Didn't you have moments when you had wrecks and accidents and pick notices in the mail and things happened, but God delivered you before? So if God delivered you before, what shall we say to these things?
Right.
You ought to be holding on to something that's going to give you a little help this morning.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah, and let me see if I can make this live for you. Reverend Akers, I used to have a blue Mustang. I used to love that car. Man, that car was my best friend for a long time. It was a 5.0 S281 Saline. Must have had a Kenny Bell supercharger. I took and put a German Paxton 6-speed gear shift in and put a Ford 10-inch rear end on. It was ready to run at any moment in time. I just, say something or we're going to do something. That was my motto. Say something or we're going to do something. I was scared of nobody. I love that car. And I had to keep it real nice and clean. One day I went to a cookout though, and after eating, barbecue chicken and ribs and everything, and having a good old time listening to music. Now I know some of y'all ain't never gonna listen to worldly music, so pray for me. I got ready to go home, so I got in my car. But there was a big spider on my windshield. I told y'all earlier I didn't like spiders. I told you it was gonna come back up.
Yeah.
But I'm looking at the spider and I'm trying to make a decision because I just cleaned my car, so I don't want to mess it up. Because if I try to kill the spider, it's going to mess up my windshield.
Uh-huh.
Now, Deacon Turner, you might want to turn your ears off on this part because, well, I don't know the statute of limitations. That was back in 19. Y'all might be good. So I decided, you know what? I got the power. So I'm going to do what I want to do.
I get in my car, close the door, roll up all the windows so the spider can't get inside.
Yeah.
Then I cut the car on and moved on out. I said, yeah, it's moving now. You better get out the window. He stayed in place. So then I went and got out on the street and started driving kind of fast, weaving in and out of traffic. And he shaked a little bit. Oh, yeah, you better get on off. You better get on off because you in the wrong place. So then I got mad. I said, oh, so you just gonna think you bad. Gonna just stay on my window. You know, the window I clean. I cleaned the window, but I didn't do it for you. So I made a left on a street, and it was a long straightaway. And I just started hitting gears. And I went up from 60 to 70 to 80 to 90, you know, some other numbers on up there. And it seemed like, in my mind, because of all the wind ripping and the turbulence and the rocking and the shaking of the car, that the spider would have flown off. But he just seemed to hunker down and hang on to the windshield. And right by the time I got to the end of the road, I couldn't figure out how he kept hanging on when I knew the conditions were terrible for him. He had to feel like he was in a hurricane and he could not control, but he kept hanging on. So I whipped the car around way too fast and spun around a couple times. But when I whipped the car around, I was facing the opposite direction and the sun was in my purview. And when the sun hit my windshield, I realized that there was a spider web that had laid out on the windshield. And the spider was not holding on to the windshield, but he was holding on to the spider web. And I couldn't see it before, but because the sun shone on it, I was able to see it in that moment. Let me lift this up a little higher for you. People are going to look at you and say, how do you keep holding on? How do you keep just staying when it looks like you should that the life's turbulence should rock you and roll you? How do you keep coming up to church with a smile on your face? How do you keep going to the grocery store with a smile on your face? People talking about you and doing stuff behind your back, and you keep smiling and say, Jesus will fix it after a while. What's wrong with you? You ought to tell him, I'm holding on to something that you can't see. Because my faith is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. And because I'm holding on to my faith in Christ, you can't see him, but it's holding me even in the wind.
Oh, yeah.
And so let the winds blow. Let the storm come. Let them say what they want to say and do what they want to do. I'm holding on to my faith in Jesus. And as long as I'm holding on to my faith in him, everything will be all right. And then tell him, well, if you stand in the right spot, you'll see it for yourself.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
What are you holding on to this morning?
Right.
What's keeping you? What's keeping you? And when they're talking about what's keeping you when bills keep going up and money keeps going down? What's keeping you when you get doctor's bills and medical bills? What's keeping you in the moments when the door slams and your fear wants to strike up?
Mm-hmm.
What's keeping you?
All right.
It's got to be your faith in God.
Yes.
Paul knows that it's his faith in God that's keeping you. Because of his faith in God, he's not worried about what people say.
Mm-hmm.
He's not worried about what people are going to do. He says, what shall we say to these things? We'll say that we're more than overcomers. We're more than conquerors through him that loves us.
Yeah.
What shall we say to these things? He should say, we shall say he can do exceedingly and abundantly above all that I can ask for then. What shall we say to these things? In God, all things are possible, if only we believe. What shall we say to these things? We are the head and not the tail. What shall we say? We'll say that in Jesus, everything's going to be all right. All we have to do is do what he told us to do. Don't back down. Don't sit down. Don't shut down. But you stay holding on to your faith. Hold on.
Hold on.
If God be for us, who can be against us? Just hold on. Hold on. Because then he says something, and I'm done now, that I love. In verse 35, he says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, angels nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in our Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing will separate us. Nothing. Now here's the funny thing. Because it wasn't so much that the spider hung onto the web. Because I do some research. But I realized that the web has sticky properties in it. So all you have to do is make contact with it. And it'll hold on to you. I never said it again. All you have to do is make contact with it. And it'll hold on to you.
Yes.
All you gotta do is make contact with Jesus' blood. All you gotta do is make contact with your faith in him, and he will hold on to you.
Amen.
Amen.
He'll hold you. Amen. And he'll rock you in the midnight hour. Yeah. He'll keep you strong when all else is failing you. What are you holding on to?
Thank you.
What are you believing in? What are you trusting in? You can't trust the news. Not always. You can't trust the government always. You can't trust people always. But I can always trust God. Because he never leaves us or forsakes us. And here's the thing. I don't know if today's my last day. Let's just be honest. I hope I get another 50 or 60 years. I told the Lord I'd like to be about 110. Well, you can pick your number. Don't look at me. I said, I'd like to hit about 110.
Yeah.
Still in good mind, still in good health.
Yeah.
Still walk around telling people, Jesus.
That's right.
Jesus. All
right.
That's all I got.
Yeah.
Somebody asked me, man, Rev, how you live so long? Jesus.
Amen.
You gotta try.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. But if I don't make 110, well, whatever day I get, this one thing I'm sure.
Thank you.
That every day with Jesus is worth it, no matter what I have to go through.
All right.
Because on my worst day, he carried me.
Mm-hmm.
On my best day, he walked with me.
Yes.
Because he told me he never leave me or forsake me.
That's right.
And from then till now, he's not ever not kept his word.
Amen.
So I hold on to my faith.
Yes.
I told somebody, I said, look, the Bible says that we have to be harmless, wise as serpents, but harmless as doves.
Mm-hmm.
So that means that as a people, we are to walk wisely as we navigate through this world. But that harmless as a dove piece does not mean that we can't defend. What it means is we do not intentionally do harm to others. And so I'm going to walk in faith. But I'm going to be wise in the way that I walk. And then I'm going to treat other people the way I want to be treated. Because my faith says everything will be all right.
Oh yeah.
So when you leave here this afternoon and you go on your separate destination, remember what you're holding on to. And then, more importantly, remember that it's also holding on to you.
Yeah.
Amen.
Because there'll be some moments where friends aren't there to back you up. But Jesus will be there.
Yes.
Amen.
There'll be some moments where nobody will answer the phone.
Yes.
But Jesus will be there.
Amen.
As we stand all over the room, as we prepare.